Jacob here with Sarasenia Northwest. In this video, I'm going to show you how I would divide up a colony of Darlingtonia like this. A customer came by and wanted us to take this apart for her. It was getting too unruly and she didn't know how to do it. And frankly, I'm not even sure how I would do it because it is a very, very tight colony. It's definitely overgrown its pot. And it's about 3 years old. It started off with three large plants, and then over time, it just exploded. Now, normally I would have my camera system and a microphone for this type of video. I just couldn't get it all set up yet. So I don't have a mic on me. I'm using my phone to film this. I just thought that this was way too cool to pass up. Anyway, I want to give you a closer look of this colony here. It's pretty darn cool. All right, now I'm tipping this over a bit, and you can see here, she had used a netted pot, and the stolons, this is called a stolon, this kind of stem here, it had grown through the netted pot and produced a plantlet right through the pot. And there's multiple plantlets like that, and some are just hanging out like this one here. Not sure how well you can see that. And you can see roots here at the bottom of the pot coming out. And if I tip it this way, where now you're looking at the top of the colony, and it is jam-packed with plants. So the first step I would do in taking this apart is to use my scissors and clip away all of the plantlets that had grown through here and removing the roots. And then after I remove the roots from the outside, then I can find a way to remove the entire colony from this pot. So let me do that. I got my scissors right here, and I'm just gonna go close to the pot as possible and just make a snip. And there we go. Here's one plant, pretty nice specimen. I have some water here, so I need to store the plants while I do this part. There's another one here that's kind of stuck to the pot. There we go. Another nice size clump. And there's a small plantlet. Now it doesn't have that much roots on it, but we'll see how well it grows. And there's a lot more stuff to clip. And this is a stolon. Oh my goodness, it grew under the lip of this pot here. Oh my goodness, yeah, it's really overgrown. Now, unfortunately, I do have to clip off roots, and some plants will get sacrificed in this process, might not survive, but that's how the story goes when you're working with a situation like this. You can't salvage all plants. Sometimes you have to sacrifice a few for the great good of the colony. And here's another clump. Here's a stolon. That little growth here is called a stolon, S-T-O-L-O-N. And you got a plantlet at the very end. I need to flip this over. Now this one didn't have any roots on it, but I don't know. We'll see if it'll take. Oh my goodness. Holy. I have to watch my language here. As a nursery man, I tend to talk like a sailor at times. Anyway, there's this huge plant here. that I'm gonna try to tease away, but I need to cut the roots. There's nowhere around it. I do need to save the pot. Otherwise, I would have cut through the pot, but she wanted the pot back. She wanted me to replant the pot with three large clumps, plants. Anyway, there's sufficient roots on here for it to take. And what is this, you might be asking? Well, I don't know what this is for. It might be a part of her growing technique. My guess is that she pumps water through here and it shoots water into across the roots. Help keep the roots cool and aerated. Water circulation is important when growing Darlingtonia. Stagnant water is the bane of a Darlingtonia's life, but it's not something we all can achieve, including us. It's not something that we're able to achieve here at the nursery, and I will admit that we have lost many and many Darlingtonia here in Oregon. Even though Darlingtonia is native to the state, yeah, look at that. Ideally the roots would be longer, but it's sufficient. I'll have to clean this up. Okay. All right, now I'm gonna attempt to get this colony out, and I put it on its side like this, and I'm just gonna grab the plants by the leaves and pitchers and see if I can tease this pot away from the colony. It is tight in there. Okay, I see. There is a tubing that goes across here. I don't know if you can see it from there, but there's a tubing here and it goes around the pot. So I'm going to have to remove some of the plants. I don't want to remove that tubing. But there are some plants that had grown between the pot and the tubing, so I'm gonna have to remove those plants. And I'll do that right now. Again, not all of these plants will survive. And if this was my only plant in the world and it was super, super, super rare, I might take my time about this. But being a nursery owner, and it's March, springtime, I have, oh gosh, over 1,000 plants to process. This is just one of many, many plants that we're processing this month. And I don't have a lot of time to do this gingerly. Okay, here we go. Now, it's always distressing to hear roots being torn out. You can hear that sound, that crunching sound, kind of like the sound of bones cracking. That's the best way to describe it. And I know a lot of new growers probably just freak out about my unpotting technique, but I know from experience that Darlingtonia can be pretty resilient. You just gotta know how to treat them well afterwards. Actually, Darlingtonia can be a pain in the butt. It's the Goldilocks of carnivorous plants. But, yeah, look at that. Now this is what I would look for in a division. Nice healthy roots. But again, you gotta sacrifice the few for the greater good. And whew, there we go. Look at that. All right. Now we got this out of the pot. There's a bunch of roots here, or stolons. Some plant pots. Let's see, this soil she used is well aerated, peat moss and perlite and some pea gravel. Pretty good. I do the sniff test. Smells pretty earthy. So the soil is healthy for being 3 years old, and that's really key to healthy soil, to a healthy Darlingtonia. You got to keep the soil healthy. Fungus, root fungus, is the main culprit of Darlingtonia, and that's why they're so difficult to grow in warm environments, because they get very prone to fungal disease when it's warm. And that's why at lower elevations can be difficult in growing Darlingtonia. Let me turn this batch around this way, and you can see all the roots here. And all I'm doing now is knocking off the soil. And again, I'm not doing this exceedingly gently. I've been accused of being really rough with plants, but I just know that the plants can tolerate it. So I'm just shaking up the soil. Yeah. And as I do that, it becomes very easy to divide the colony. This one's kind of stuck together by a stolon. So what happened was that one plant sent out a stolon, probably this larger one, and then produced a plantlet on this other end. But since this one has lots of roots on it, I can easily break that apart and separate the two plants. All right. Anyway, and we got something like this. That will just get tucked away for now. So that is how I would divide up a colony like this. The next step is to go through here, clean up the plants, and then pot them up. Now, before I get to processing the plants, I wanted to show you this really cool pot. As I suspected, water does flow up through here and it creates a drip system. Now, we do encourage using a drip system whenever possible, because what it does, it brings water from the top through the soil, and it helps two things. It helps aerate the soil, and it flushes out fungal spores. In this particular case, water is pumped up through here, goes through along this pipe, and along the pipe I see little holes along the way, and so it's just dripping water, a constant drip system. And again, it aerates the soil and flushes out fungal spores. This is pretty cool. Okay, I have a plant here. It's soaked in water. I rinsed off all of the soil. You can see some nice healthy roots here. The roots are fairly thin. They're not like Sarracenia roots that are thick and white. These are very thin and dark. You got some stolons here coming off. But what I'm gonna do is cut off those stolons, because they kind of just get in the way. And then I'm gonna clip off all of the older leaves here, or the dried up leaves, not the older leaves. All of these leaves were produced from last season. Right now, the plant is dormant. This is a very good time to be doing this project. Here's a very large picture on it. I'll keep this. But overall, here's the plant. Oh, we got two here. So I'm just gonna, there we go. They came apart. Two plants. Very nice, healthy plant. Okay, I'm done processing the Darlingtonia. What I did, I cut off all the dead material, and I sorted the Darlingtonia out into two bins. One, the first bin here, are plants that have really good root systems for the size of the plant. Really healthy roots, a very healthy plant. And then this bin here are plants that didn't have really good roots. The roots are very scant. But all of these plants probably need some special care to get them going. We'll have to segregate them and keep an eye out on them. But these, the plants in this bin, are ready to be potted up. And that's what I'm gonna do right now. I have a mix of sphagnum moss, sphagnum peat moss, perlite, and pea gravel. Normally on a Darlingtonia mix, I would use a mix of one part peat moss and two parts perlite. In this mix, I did equal parts of sphagnum peat moss, perlite, and pea gravel. I added the pea gravel because that's what the customer had in this pot here. So I'm gonna replicate the same soil mix. All right, time to repot. I'm placing this elevated on this bin here because of this tubing. Anyway, I just add in some soil. That's probably a good level for now. And this customer wanted three large plants, so I'm gonna select three of the largest ones here. And I make a hole, just like that. And place the plant in as deep as I can. And all that stolons get covered up too, just like that. And I don't go too deep. I just go to where the plant looks natural, right in the soil line. That's about it. Now I do a second one. We'll do this one here, which is really large, very large. All the stolons here, I might have to cut these off, but we'll see. Again, I make a hole. Place everything in. And the stolons will help form new plants, get this colony restarted. Add some soil to the sides. And just make sure the plant is secured. And a third one right here. We'll go with this plant. And you can see the stolon here has a plantlet at the end. So we'll just lay that on the soil. Grab a bit more here and cover everything up. Just like that. In the back, we'll get that down. I'll have to secure this down, that stolon, with a bit more soil, and eventually in time that will produce roots and form its own plantlet that can survive on its own away from the mother plant. Well, I'm done potting up all the plants. This process took a lot quicker than I anticipated. Overall, it took me 2 hours. Let's see, I ended up with a dozen large plants in 6-inch pots. And I also had a dozen medium plants in 4-inch pots. And you might notice that I top dressed the soil with live sphagnum moss. And that's mostly to make it easier to top water the Darlingtonia. I also took all of the stragglers, plants that didn't have good roots. I just stuck them in a tray of sphagnum moss. And I'll check up on them in a few months, see how the roots are growing. But you know what? The best growing medium for Darlingtonia is sphagnum moss. That's what we've discovered. The only downside to that is that it's very difficult to cultivate sphagnum moss on a large scale. You think Darlingtonia is hard, sphagnum moss is even harder. We just couldn't cultivate it, enough of it, to satisfy a retail market, not to mention what we use here at the nursery. We use sphagnum moss very sparingly, and mostly we use it for Darlingtonia. Anyway, you got to see me from start to finish bust apart a very large colony of Darlingtonia. It's hard to imagine that all the plants you see here on this table came from this pot right here. I will say that this was the tightest colony I've ever had to work with. Ideally, it should have been busted apart maybe last year, but we were in a pandemic and my customer couldn't come over. But got it done, and so now this goes back to her. And you also got to see me how rough I can be with these plants. But also just keep in mind that I've been working with Darlingtonia and Sarracenia and a bunch of other carnivorous plants for 20 plus years. And in that experience, in that time, I've got to see what these plants can take. And what the way I worked with the plants, they can take that, especially in their dormancy in early spring or late winter, as it is now. Anyway, I know I brought up a lot of issues about growing Darlingtonia. You know, I'm gonna touch upon those issues in a later video. You can also watch our two videos on Darlingtonia. We did one, Serpent of the Siskiyous, filmed that in 2009 when the temperature was really hot in Southern Oregon. I think it got up to 104 degrees there while during our stay. And we did soil samples, soil temperatures, got a lot of good information on how we can transfer those concepts of how they live in the wild to cultivation. We also have another video that we also published in 2009, and that was from our volume one DVD, Grow Carnivorous Plants. It was part of a three DVD set. That video is online and it shows the cultivation of Darlingtonia. Anyway, now I get to tackle my collection of Darlingtonia after this. And I want to thank you for watching, and good growing.